Blackstone Publishing presents The Ghost and Mrs. Muir by R.A. Dick. This book is read by Elizabeth Jasicki. Part 1. Chapter 1. Mrs. Muir was a little woman. Everyone was agreed on that point. Where others were merely referred to as Mrs. Brown and Mrs. Smith, she was invariably spoken of as little Mrs. Muir, or dear little Mrs. Muir, and latterly as poor little Mrs. Muir, for her husband, that upright member of the church and indifferent architect, had died suddenly, leaving her with two children and an inadequate income. So inadequate, in fact, that she was forced to sell the pseudo-Elizabethan house, which he had built for her as a wedding present, in order to meet the very real debts which poured in on every side, threatening to swamp her and carry away the familiar landmarks of her married life. An opposing torrent of advice poured down on her from her husband's relatives and her acquaintances, flinging her future this way and that, now into three-roomed flats, now into semi-detached villas, now into hat shops or tea shops, and now into housekeeping for single gentlemen, while the children were swept away from her into charity schools, institutions, and even adoption. "This," said little Mrs. Muir, awakening one morning to a beam of March sunlight striking through the eastern window across her face, "this has got to stop. I must settle things for myself." And as if to encourage her in her independence, a blackbird's brave song, full of spring and new beginnings, floated up to her from the garden below. "I will leave Wychester," she said aloud, and suddenly, sitting up in bed and flinging aside the blankets, she said again, "But I will leave Wychester. Why didn't I think of it before? It's the only solution." Such a sense of freedom possessed her that she, too, sang as she dressed, snatches of melodies that she had not sung since she was a girl of 17, and Edwin Muir had come to her father's house in the country to rebuild the library wing and had remained to court her. There had been no eligible young men in Nether Whitley, and she had been reading a novel at the time, in which the hero had had a fair lock of hair falling over his forehead. Edwin's hair had grown in the same way, and her absent-minded father, who lived mainly in the past among the Greek poets, was no authority on haircuts. The novel finished with a kiss in the rose garden and the magic words, "And so they lived happily ever after." And Lucy Muir, having been kissed in the orchard, could see no other ending to her own romance. But the hero in that book had not been an only son with a widowed mother and two strong-minded sisters living almost on the doorstep. Not that her life had been unhappy. It had just not been her life at all. It had been old Mrs. Muir's life, full of medicine cupboards and emulsions to be rubbed on Edwin's chest if he should clear his throat, and tonics to be measured out three times a day after meals if he should look a little pale, and red flannel protectors and pink knitted bed socks. It had been Helen Gould's life, and Helen, Edwin's younger sister, had made her join all the clubs in the town, badminton clubs, croquet clubs, archery clubs, card clubs, and it had been Eva Muir's life, with choral societies, dramatic societies, and literary societies. What was left after all these activities and her household duties had been Edwin's. Even at night, her life had been entirely Edwin's and not her own, in the large double bed where his unfortunate habit of snoring shook even her dreams into his pattern. They left her nothing of her own. They chose her servants, her dresses, her hats, her books, her pleasures, even her illnesses. "Dear little Lucy looks pale. She must drink burgundy." And "poor little Lucy seems to be losing weight. She must take cod liver oil." Lucy, who hated love.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.